Good morning and welcome to Techspectations 2020. Today is day two of our conference and we have absolutely exciting talks, fireside chats and panel discussions lined up. Day one, if day one was any indication, day two is going to rock. We had a phenomenal set of speakers come in and share their points from their deep experience and from their expertise, decades of expertise. It's going to be phenomenal. Thank you for the lovely questions that you've been sending across. That's been very useful for us to make our sessions interactive. Wish we were all in Kochi seeing each other. I mean, the previous two editions in 2016 and 2018 was fabulous. Part of the fun was having all the participants out there, and these participants are curated, right? And you know, just as speakers are awesome, so are the audience members. We miss the chance to network and interact with us over coffee, over lunch. But we try to make do as much as possible. We have a networking lounge that is open. We're gonna encourage you that during the break, go ahead to the networking lounge. There are so many other activities that is out there. Of particular note is a photo booth. So go ahead, get your selfie taken. It's a very interesting and innovative way how the creators have made it. So go ahead and take a look at it. And when you take that selfie, you can also go ahead and share it in your social media platforms. For many of these activities like these, you earn points. There is a leaderboard. You can also find out where you fare in the leaderboard. For top people who are being very active, we're going to give away an Amazon gift voucher worth 5,000 rupees. That's worth gunning for. But more importantly, it's a good chance for you to go check out all the features and all the interesting things that have been laid out for you. So do take the time out to do that. Now, this event wouldn't be possible without partners and with association members who really come in and really help support. And I want to give a shout out to our first shows, an OTT platform that is about to launch. They are our primary sponsor. So thank you to First Shows. We have Amrita University ahead, who have online degree programs. Absolutely worth checking them out. They are our knowledge partner. And thanks to Akamai for the associate sponsors. So really appreciate it. And also hats off to scores of volunteers and the team at Manorama Online who've been working a lot, not only really working to put together this program, but trying to give as much as trying to give an experience that is closest that is possible to a real event, but done virtually. So hats off to them as well. Now, as I said, day two is chock-a-block. We have a fireside chat, then we have three action-packed panel discussions lined up. So we're going to kickstart with our first program. Our first program is a fireside chat that focuses on the streaming ecosystem. It's taken on like a storm. The pandemic has only accelerated the immense potential of what this technology has to offer. The movie theaters are all shut down. We're not even sure when we can really go and have that real movie experience out there. Sure, some of them are open, but it's not the real thing. But strangely enough, when we speak with people, people hardly seem to miss that experience. The reason the latest movies, kick-ass shows, everything is actually available for us to enjoy. Now, all the family members can gather around in our hall, in our bedrooms. We choose a time that we find it convenient for us to go and watch. And we don't have to pay through our nose for those popcorns, right? So nobody seems to be complaining. And that's the reason why you see an amazing upswing in the adoption of many of these streaming platforms out there. So to throw light on it, we have two amazing people who have come and joined in. First is Vijay Subramaniam, the director and head of content at Amazon Prime Video. Thank you for joining in, Vijay. Next is Mahesh Narayanan, film director, screenwriter, and editor of repute. He's going to join in. This is beautiful because both of them given a true balance. Vijay represents the platform, and Mahesh represents all the creators out there. So the way how we're going to do this fire chat is we will have an opening talk by each of the panelists who will share their opinion. I have laid out a bunch of questions for both of them, but I'm going to rely on you. I'm going to take your assistance in what questions do you have. So please feel free to questions for both Vijay and Mahesh. Please put them up. We will have them curated, and the relevant questions, I will take the onus of asking them on your behalf. So that's what we're going to do. We have 45 minutes. I thought we have close to about 45 minutes at play. So let's make the most of it. I'm going to invite Vijay to come and speak. Vijay is the director and head of content at Amazon Prime Video, which means that every program that you see in Amazon Prime Video has got the nod from Vijay. He's in charge of making sure of curation of shows. He works with content creators, makes sure that the customers get to benefit from high quality content. And he's someone, he's a veteran of the industry who comes with 2 decades of experience. And the best part, he's traversed all gamuts of media. He's been in print, he's been in radio, he's been in television, and right now in digital. Before Amazon, Vijay spearheaded content and revenue functions at Disney Media Networks and overseeing the growth for 8 channels. Vijay, I can't think of a better person than you to come and talk about on streaming. Thank you so much for joining in. The floor is yours.
Hey, thank you, Kiruba. Good morning, everyone. I think you give me way more credit than I deserve. So I do wanna thank the entire team that I work with. They're a bunch of incredible individuals who make my job really very easy. One, and two, as much as my career sounds really illustrious, I must admit that I'm a person who's always been an eternal student of media and entertainment, and that's what has made me get to these various places. And I'm very lucky that they kept me in these places for so long. So, on that note, again, wonderful being here. I'm truly humbled that you thought of us. And I'm even more humbled as a person to be sharing the space with Mahesh, someone who I have the highest regard for as a creator and as a visionary. So thank you. I mean, this is also personally incredibly satisfying. I think the streaming journey for us here has been pretty interesting on many counts. If you look back, it feels like we've been around for a long time, but Prime Video has actually been here for a little over 4 years. So it does feel like, oh, it's always been around and, you know, we've always had this access and so on and so forth. But it's been super exciting. It's also happening at a time when I think technological and sociological shifts are making the access of content and the choice of content even more democratic than they ever were. And that's super exciting for everyone involved in the business of content. For us, I think it's our journey here remains incredibly focused on customer centricity. I mean, everything that we do, we put her in the middle of it. I think it's, and we work backwards from there. In order to create a truly local service, it's very important for us to recognize that we cater to the diversity and of India, and that we are not serving any one India, but many of them. And therefore, it's equally important to make sure that we're able to serve each community in as meaningful a manner as we can. And that takes time and patience. And that's something that we're very committed to. The second thing that drives our thinking is really the overall experience. You know, as much as people are very comfortable with television, if you were to go back, you know, 30 years when the first remote came into our hands, or maybe even earlier, you know, it takes time for people to understand and decode. And for us, it's super important to make sure that we take that pain away. So if you look at the service, the simplicity of it, whether it's putting the controls in your hand to begin with, you decide the streaming quality, you decide how much of what kind of caps you want to put on your data, you decide in which language of audio you want to watch something, you know, and then, you know, just making sure that the algorithm is smart enough to make recommendations based on your choices that you already made, as well as helping you discover new content, means that it simplifies your overall experience. I think that's very, very important for us. In all of this, as much as the service is super important, it's equally important to have, you know, really solid genre-defining content. You know, and I think we've been blessed with the kind of partnerships and the relationships that we've been able to forge, whether it's on the film licensing side or on our shows, or on the commissioning side with our original series. If we've been really fortunate that all the biggest producers and studios across the country, we right now program in 9 languages across the country, and you know, we've had at the very early stages, we were able to take our vision to them and have them embrace it and then commit to multi-year strategic partnerships with us. And that's really holding us in good stead. I think that then again goes back to the importance of diversity of content because of the diversity of India. It's equally important to program to the many modes, you know, so the customer at some point may be interested in comedy, at some point maybe in the mood for some really gritty drama, and at some other point just want light touch viewing. And it's important to program for all these elements and continuously keep improving based on what we learn from her. Our endeavor really is to make Prime Video the theater at home. So one thing we understand very well is customers in India want their content, want the latest and the greatest content, and they want it soon. And so we've been able to meaningfully provide early windows, and we've been very focused on this. And again, this would not be possible if the producers and the studios did not see this as an important step in their own evolution of storytelling. So that's something that we've always focused on, and it's something that's paying off in significantly to everyone in the ecosystem, starting with the customer. Off late, with the pandemic and everything else, you know, we've also had the opportunity to take some of these big blockbuster films that were planned for cinemas and provide an opportunity to release them worldwide, you know, in the form of our direct-to-service premiere program. Now, I think while everybody talks about the current scenario and how this has been a big enabler to get these stories out there to the customers, we also have a long-term view to it. If you think about it, we want our commitment really is to be to enable the growth of the ecosystem. I mean, we all know that India is probably one of the lowest densities of screens per million, I mean, of all the major markets. I think we have about 9,500 cinema screens for 1.3 billion people. And if you look at that, and if you look at the opportunity that it presents us as in not just Prime Video, but the creators, the producers, the entire ecosystem, we have an opportunity to take high quality stories and present them in the best possible formats to millions and millions of people who don't necessarily have access to cinema screens, even under normal circumstances. So I think that's the endeavor of ours long-term. And finally, I think none of this would be possible if we didn't have, you know, a relentless focus on making sure that we build significant reach and access, making it easy for customers to pick up Amazon Prime Video and, you know, subscribe and get into the service with the least amount of friction. We'll talk about that, you know, in the fireside chat as well. And needless to say that, you know, we committed to making sure that we market in a very meaningful manner. And finally, we are obviously a part of the Prime program, which has multiple benefits, Prime Video being one of them. There's shopping, shipping, music and video. So that's great value for the overall package to customers. And we're going to continue to look at that as a hybrid program, for customers in India. So that's really been the journey so far. I'm giving you a flavor of all the facets or all the levers that we've been using, and I'm happy to talk about them in more detail as we get into the fireside chat. Once again, thank you for having me here.
Thank you, Vijay. That was that's a beautiful context set. I have tons of questions. In fact, there's been a lot of interest in Amazon Prime Video, the business model, and so I'll have them shoot to you once we get to the fireside chat. Now, we're moving on to Mahesh Narayanan. As Vijay said, Mahesh is a film director, screen writer, and an editor of repute. His editorial debut, Ratri Maza, backed the National Award for the Best Director and won 5 state Kerala awards, Kerala State Awards. In 2017, Mahesh made his debut as a director and shot a movie called Take Off. It's a 2017 Indian drama thriller film based on the ordeals of Indian nurses in Iraq. The film went on to win 2 national awards and 5 Kerala State Awards, and including, once again, the Best Debut Director Award for Mahesh Narayanan. Things didn't slow down during lockdown. So during the lockdown, he made a movie called See You Scene, India's first screen-based feature, which you can see it on Amazon Prime Video. Mahesh, we are very excited to hear your points of view. Over to you, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Kriba. Thank you, Manorama, for inviting us. And thank you. I'm happy that Vijay is also here. So we are people we're constantly in touch with. So happy that Vijay is here. So we can talk and discuss further. So the thing is, me being a filmmaker, I started off as an editor. I'm working in this industry for last 15 years. And it's more like, I switched from editor to writer to director. So the main thing is the kind of freedom what we get when we make a film, the kind of association what we have with actors, with producers, with the relationship between technicians and everyone. So that's the harmony where we can make a good content possible. So in relation to the subject what we're talking about, I don't have much experience on the streaming content other than See You Soon. That happened, everybody will say that film happened because of lockdown. But even though it was not lockdown situation, the film would have been very, very similar. So, it was at that point, I realized that when the theaters were all shut and it was an uncertain situation, which is still uncertain right now. So, I've been there were a lot of people. It's not about technicians and actors who are paid in a higher level, but there are assistant directors, assistant editors, since I've been working in this industry for the last 15 years, I've got a lot of editors some of my assistants as editor working as assistant editors are senior editors here. So most of them started moving into some other sector like small jobs, one guy started cooking from home, sending a home delivery for food. I'm not telling that those jobs are not good, but I respect them. But they were all good technique. They're all they're all super excited and super talented technicians. So the problem is they were all uncertain. So I started getting phone calls at many odd hours, asking that, okay, what is the future? How are we going to cope up with? What is the new normal? Do you have any idea about it? So then that's the moment we started realizing that every industry, media industry or the IT sector, hospital sector, every industry has got a work from home format. Everybody has got a work from home, just like how this session has been held up virtually. I'm sitting in my place, Vijay sitting in Vijay's place, in Cuba, you're somewhere else. So then I thought of what is the problem with this cinema industry? Because cinema is a collective art form, and in terms of content, in terms of fiction content. So I thought of making it a try. Let's make a film which could be made with a limited amount of crew. Like, you know, let's cut the number and restrict the number, reduce it to 50 member crew. And let's make a film like within our home spaces, within our you know, available resources. Let's make it innovative in a way that, like, available resources, let's play around with it. So that's the kind of strength, I've received from all my fellow technicians. They were all super confident and you know, they believed in me. And finally, I got a person like Vijay to have conviction on my content, and it went out on Amazon. So the thing is, like, the whole film was conceived during the lockdown, and we started filming by June. And it got released on Amazon September 1st. So it's actually a super speedy timeline. I could never imagine some kind of a timeline like that. So, you know, so moving on to next, like, what's the new normal in the entertainment sector? That's the next future. So I'm thinking that, you know, as Vijay said, pointed out very correctly, that India is lacking number of screens in terms of theatrical. Like, you know, the proportion is very wrong when you compare with the US or UK or Europe. The thing is, even China, like, so the thing is, I'm under an assumption that where India is heading through like super advancement in technology, in vice of technology, where, you know, where once this 5G spectrum is going to hit India, like, you know, like, I don't know who's going to take up this 5G bandwidth, but at that moment onwards, this whole you know, streaming system is going to change for a lot. And I'm under an assumption that, you know, theaters are going to be streaming, you know, in the near future. Theaters are going to be streaming because we have, there have been immense research which is happening on this large LED displays, which is called the cinema display walls, where the theaters are going to be with low maintenance things. And you know, they need not be an operator in the theater, and somebody who can actually share a computer from their home can actually access the screen there, and it's very convenient. And so the distribution format is going to be a revolution, and where, you know, where a film which is made in Malayalam, which is comparatively a very regional language down of South India, so that film can be viewed in the same time in somewhere in New Zealand, somewhere in Australia, somewhere anywhere. Like, so that's the kind of advantage which we are going to, like, and that too, an immersive experience inside a theater. So that's the future which I'm predicting, like, that's where we are heading to. So another thing, like, you know, I have to make a point, like, you know, when I started writing something for a streaming platform, like, you know, it is more tricky than writing a film for a theater. Because, you know, as Vijay pointed out very well, because, you know, people are used to this device called the remote. You know, it is a challenging thing. Yeah, like, you know, it is more interactive with people. So the thing is, you know, people can something which is less intriguing. If we are not getting that emotional connect straight away, or if you are not bringing in that inciting incident straight away directly on the 10th minute or the 5th minute, then we can lose that, the continuity for the audience. So they can, they have a possibility to skip also. So in that way, I'm initially I thought, okay, if I'm writing something for this, for the streaming content, okay, I can have some kind of a liberty where I can, like, play around, add little bit of, spacing between the characters, and the storyline can be much relaxed and all. But it's not that. It's very tricky. So now I'm learning that. It's every day I'm learning that. I'm into that R&D thing now. Like, I'm researching into that. So this is what, and I'm happy that, you know, whatever way we make, we are all content creators. Like, our basic intention is to reach it to the maximum number of people. So that happened during CUSOL, because initially when me and my producer Fahad, we were having that just a week before the release of CUSOL on Amazon Prime, like, you know, we had a small discussion where we thought, okay, will it be the same kind of response from the people for the first day? But it was spontaneous and it was, like, overwhelming. Why? Because, you know, we were getting phone calls at odd hours and all. Like, I'm really looking forward to this new venue where I'm not against theaters and all. I'm like, we all want the theaters to be back, but this is also a new platform where, you know, where creators are willing to provide content. So I'm happy for being a part of this ecosystem. So I'm happy to share my views, and we move on to the further discussion. Thank you, Kripa.
Thanks a lot, Mahesh. Very interesting insights, and lots of questions are there for you as well. I'm going to start off with Vijay. Vijay, how did the... I want to dive specifically into Amazon Prime Video, and then we'll go on to OTT platforms in general. How did the idea of Amazon Prime Video come from an organization that primarily focuses only on shopping?
Well, actually, that's not the most accurate description of Amazon. What Amazon really primarily focuses on is customers, all right, and their everyday lives, and how we can add value to their everyday lives, either by simplifying it or by adding dimensions to it that make enrich their lives. So if you think about Amazon, there are many ways you can think about Amazon. Sure, it started with e-commerce and retail, and so that kind of becomes very obvious. But there's AWS, the largest cloud services in company in the world. That's also Amazon. There's Prime Video, there's music, there's logistics, there's voice, Alexa, you know, and there are devices, there's Kindle, there's reading. So I think it's really important to, for us, when we think about what are the benefits that we can hopefully create in the lives of customers, clearly entertainment was one of those. All right. And so the journey was pretty obvious. If customers are seeking entertainment, then it is our responsibility to provide that to them in a manner that they see value in, and obviously of high quality and everything else, because the customer, she knows best. And so that's how the journey started, Kiruba. You know, it, of course, it started first in the US and then parts of Europe. And then, you know, it was very clear for us that being an integral part of the Prime membership program, and India being strategically so important for us, you know, we knew that when we get here, we will have to come here all guns blazing. And that's exactly what we've done.
So thanks for that, Vijay. The question deeper is, was Prime Video created as an extra value addition for members as a way to give them more value and make them come and take the Prime membership? Was it how it started? And then it grew really big that it started to you know, be a standalone feature by itself.
So you're right. You know, early in the origins of Prime Video, it was one more element that added value to the overall Prime membership program. We're very proud to be a part of that program. And what has happened through our journey is that it's not good enough to just be of meaningful value. It's important to be of significant value, because entertainment is front and center in everybody's lives, right? And so we started, you know, focusing more and more on that. And, you know, and to your point that we're at, and now when we look at, by the time we got to India, it was very clear that we need a full-fledged video service alongside the Prime to make the Prime membership program even meatier. So yes, you're absolutely right in how the evolution of Prime Video has happened.
Got it. Thanks, Vijay. Mahesh, you mentioned about an interesting fact about India lacking the number of screens, and we fall far behind that of US or UK. But now, with mobile phones being the screens of choice, are we not number one or number two in the world?
See, that's a different aspect. You know, we're talking about a theatrical experience where, you know, people are immersed into a particular zone where they're coming into, they're taking a book, taking a ticket, and dedicated their time for a particular film. So that's a different experience. So this is the, what you mentioned is about the other zone where, you know, where just to, you know, I have a little bit of 10 minutes of time or 10 minutes of gap, so I can watch at least 10 minutes of one season or a film. And then we can pause it, we can forward it. You know, that's another kind of viewing. So that is not dedicated viewing. So I'm not talking, I'm strictly speaking about dedicated viewing. So how to make this film, like, you know, if somebody starts a film on a mobile phone, a filmmaker will get an advantage if that person switches from that mobile phone to a TV. And if at all, if he's having a smaller, a bigger screen in his house, let's say if he or she's having a home theater setup in his or her house, and slowly it is proceeding, like progressing and transcending into that screen, then that makes the content the king. So, you know, in that way, the content always wins. So that's a separate viewing system. Yeah.
You also made a very interesting statement, Mahesh, that there's a huge difference and a challenge for filmmakers for making films for the big screen versus OTT platforms. Can you go a little deeper and tell us what those challenges are?
See, I will tell you, like, you know, normally a script is written in various acts. You know, there will be first act. First act will be like primarily, I'm not diving into more like filmmaking kind of a masterclass, but I'm just telling you, like, the first act will be some kind of an exposition of characters. Then we move into the second act, which will end up with the inciting incident. So then we'll go into that, you know, the midpoint. So the midpoint is this is the regular sit-feel structure which Hollywood films and all follow. So the midpoint eventually ended up as the interval point for Indian films. So then it will go into the next act, so the pre-climax and the climax, and then the culmination part, maybe the tail end or something like that. So, you know, this is the regular structure what we follow. So what happens when you write a content for a streaming thing, like, you know, from the first scene onwards, we'll have to make sure that whatever emotion what we're throwing, like, let it be humor, let it be any kind of a genre, like if it's a horror film or if it's a satire, anything, like, you know, you'll have to make yourself, you know, sure that this inciting incident, this intrigue factor or this clinging thing, that has to come much earlier so that, you know, people should not miss it. So, you know, at times they have this possibility to, you know, I've seen a plenty of viewers where, you know, they say that, oh, I don't want to see this scene. Let me forward it. I know what is going to happen. This is predictable. I know what is going to happen. So that's a challenge what filmmakers are facing right now. So this all happened from various series or shows which happened in the West when interactive shows started coming up. Interactive shows, I'm not talking about, like, you know, a show is turning into, shifting into some other genre. I'm telling about interactive in the sense, like, you know, whatever you are getting, like, we are predicting, like, sometimes we predict a scene. Okay, this is going to happen next. So it is completely the opposite which is going to happen. And so then that's a time when, you know, when the viewer gets glued into that thing. So that's a bigger challenge. So in comparison with theatrical films, you know, sometimes we'll go into a mobile phone. Sometimes we'll have that popcorn thing. We'll have chat discussions and all, like, what, you know, that is regular. So, you know, that's a difference. So this is a small kind of a definition what I can define right now. But, you know, when I'm working on like even I'm new to this streaming content. So I'm still learning out of it. Like, I'm learning from all my experiences. Yeah.
Thank you, Mahesh. Mm-hmm. Vijay, let's talk about business models of OTT platforms. When you look at television, when they screen a movie, it's very clear. They get their money from the ads that they put while they show the movie. It's very clear in theaters that there are tickets, box office collection that happens, and that's how they make money. But what about OTT? We don't see too many ads out there. So what? How do OTT platforms make money?
So I'm not an expert on OTT, because OTT covers practically everything from Instagram live to YouTube to practically the entire ecosystem. In general, you have models that are AVOD, which is, you know, best exemplified as you put content there, you know, you build a pretty healthy user base, and then you monetize that content through ads. That's pretty simplistic, and that exists, right? And then you have the hybrid, which is predominantly for advertising, and a sliver of it is premium, where people have to subscribe to pay. Our service is a pure video on demand streaming service, which is subscription based. And the subscription obviously is that you become a Prime member and you derive this benefit. And that's what we remain focused on. So every piece of content for us has to enable new customers or compel them to join engage existing customers enough to keep them there. I mean, it's that simple. And I think it's important not to overcook this because it's pretty straightforward, right? Content is an incredibly important input for an entertainment streaming service. That's the truth even in television. I mean, why would you watch TV if there was no content, right? So people tend to, try to, slice and dice this in too many ways. And I think that's not necessarily true. And it's not also true that television only plays movies because they get ads, because it's also important content. It's an important category of content that has a role in the life of the customer. So similarly for us, we make sure that we're building a compelling catalog of content that's diverse, as representative as it can get for the diversity of this country, with the sole purpose of making sure that the customers see value in the overall Prime membership program and keeping them engaged so that they remain on the service. Now, long term, what we do want to become is the preferred choice of entertainment for Indian customers. That's our goal. And every step we take, we make sure that our long term vision is embedded in it. So that if you track back the journey, the number of languages we've launched, the kind of content categories we've selected, the things we've done during the pandemic, including the big DTS releases across the languages, working and path-breaking content like See You Soon, all of this goes to also further our vision of wanting or seeking validation from our customers in the long term that we are their preferred choice of entertainment.
Thank you, Vijay. There's a question from Nived Ravindran. He wants to ask about the future of theaters. You mentioned about 5G. When 5G comes in, it's going to be super smooth to stream movies. People can sit and watch at home. They don't have to pay. They don't have to travel. So is the chance for theaters only to survive by giving the experience of big screen? What do you see the future of theaters?
So theaters are always going to be there. It's not that theaters are going to, people are under a wrong assumption that, okay, the new normal the primary thing is that vaccination has to be there. That is the truth. Okay. So once this whole pandemic situation is settling down, then definitely theaters will come back. And we always want that, theater experience and theater viewing audience to grow. That's the only possibility of an industry to grow. We always need a mass film. Like if you look at Malayalam, we need a film like Lucifer, which is a mass masala kind of like a big film, and also a small film which is made in terms of like academic aspects also. So that's a bandwidth for a region to deliver the content. So my thing is, I just mentioned that specific thing about the 5G spectrum only to share you that theaters are going to be onto that streaming side, where we get good quality. Nowadays, like I'll tell you an example. Nowadays, we are shooting in high resolution cameras, 8K, 6K, but our theaters are still running in 2K. And I'm getting a good 4K viewing experience in Amazon or Netflix. So in that way, my biggest picture quality is I'm getting that biggest resolution on that screen. It's not about the area of coverage. I'm talking about the resolution. So when this streaming thing is going to switch into theaters will naturally become a more you know, technically superb environment where, you know, where when you're watching a film which is made like a Tenet or a James Bond movie, it is like a massive experience, or a Bahubali, it will be like a massive experience. So that is what we miss right now. We don't. I'm still looking forward for, like, you know, theaters to get back on track and to have that first day, first show viewing experience. So that will be always there. Yeah.
Kiruba, I just wanted to add. I second everything Mahesh said. I just wanted to add two more dimensions because that's a very good question. The fact is that. While the social experience or the community experience of theater going is an integral part of how we entertain ourselves, that's existed forever. All right. The choices customers make will keep changing. And so the onus is on the creator to give them a compelling reason to come to the theaters. Right. And that's how creators will keep upgrading themselves, and providing fresh, interesting content for them to watch. There are two challenges in India, however. The fact that there are only 9,500 screens today, and that's been the story for the past 5 or 7, 8 years, hasn't gone away. And our point was really long-term, we want to enable creators to go beyond that limitation using us. There's an interesting phenomenon at play right now, which is as television technology upgrades, I'm talking about the hardware, and the cost of smart TVs has been dramatically coming down. All right. These provide a near theatrical experience at home at a very affordable cost for the hardware. And on the other hand, data costs have been coming down. So there is this opportunity that we remain committed to, which complements everything else that already exists in terms of the conventional distribution pipeline.
Got it. So Vijay, here's a question from a question for Mahesh. This is from Gayatri, and she asks, "What were the constraints of making a movie?" She's referring to See You Soon during pandemic with all the restrictions in place.
I think I've addressed this thing in many interviews. So the thing is, like, you know, as I said earlier, like normally in a regular shooting space where, you know, on average basis for a Malayalam film or a regional language film, there will be like 150 to 200 people on daily basis. So when this guideline from the state government came in saying that, okay, we can have 50 member crew, including that includes all actors, technicians, and everyone. It's like, so we thought of giving it a try, like, you know, when See You Soon filming was happening, the cases in Kerala was hardly like less than 50. Now it's on an average basis, it's more than like 3,500 to 4,000. So that situation is entirely different. So now, like at that point, you know, we were a little scared, but and scared in terms of, like, you know, we don't want to we don't want to move out of any places, stay in hotel rooms and all. So that, you know, going into a location, shifting from one location to another will cause a lot of mess ups. That's still happening around here. So, assembling all under one roof and getting everything done under one roof. That's a great advantage what I had of working with a film like See You Soon. Because See You Soon is the only film where, you know, which actually I made post-production in entire 4K resolution. And the whole film went out in 4K from my editing table. So I gridded myself. So it is like my freedom is endless. Like, you know, I'm getting I'm viewing it in the correct resolution. So there are no third persons, middlemen in between. So that's a great advantage. And now when we are thinking at this new normal, how to function. So we are basically looking at, you know, multitasking. Like if there is a camera attender, so normally, regularly, a camera comes with 3 attenders. So we have reduced it to 1 attender. And that attender, if he's getting some time, he will also be the boom operator. So it is something like that. We are actually doing multitasking. So that is the new normal for me. Yeah.
Got it. Thanks for that, Mahesh. Here's a question that I definitely expected to come, and it did come. And this is from Abhilash. So Abhilash represents the community of content creators. And the question to you is, what's the one biggest parameter for Amazon to acquire a Malayalam content piece? When you say Malayalam content piece, you can replace that with any other language, I would assume. Any specific tips for small-time vernacular content creators?
Well, there are a whole bunch of, you know, proprietary tools that we use that I'm not at liberty to divulge. But this, the simple first headline bullet point for us is always the story. It always starts with the story. I still remember, I'll give you the illustration of See You Soon since Mahesh is here. When Fahad first spoke to me, all right, the phone, the conversation was a very different conversation. It was about this story and I found it really interesting. All right, he shared a synopsis and this was his concern. He says, Vijay, I'm very intrigued. Mahesh has brought this to me and I'm very intrigued. And this was early March. I don't think the pandemic had even started. All right. And or the lockdown had started. I don't remember. I'm a little fuzzy, but it wasn't like, oh my God, this is going to be put together during the lockdown. It was his question to me was, I don't want the film to be longer than 90 minutes. I remember this distinctly. And he says, do you have a problem with that? Now, the conviction on the creator's part that the story is such that I am not going to even dedicate an extra minute to it was an equal parts compelling for us, because not only is it a great story, but the vision of the creator is that it needs to be delivered in a certain way. So that's really what we look for. It always starts with a story. And I must admit that, you know, in the past, thanks to the way we've been able to help the producer and the creator ecosystem understand our intentions, everybody's happy sharing scripts with us. They even take our feedback, because there are times when we commit really early, right? And, you know, there are times when we say, I'm unable to make a decision because I'm unclear. So I will need to see it for us to be able to make a decision. So it's a path of collaboration that really works. And finally, for all the creators out there, the truth is that choices are infinite and resources are finite. So there is, and this is the business of art. So there will be choices that we make, both in favor and against, that may not necessarily at a micro level seem like the right one, but you know, ultimately, when you see the portfolio, you realize that, oh, they went for variety here. They had too much of this and that. And that's really how we work with everyone. And finally, it's important for aspiring creators to do the hard work here. You know, the one thing that I have in my experience, you know, in the position that I'm in, the one thing that I always impart to everyone is, listen, ideas are great, but to give birth to a screenplay, or forget a screenplay, a story, takes a lot of work, you know? And that, I believe, is a step that a lot of people think can be gamed or taken lightly or, you know, skipped, in fact. And I always encourage them. And finally, I also want to say that it's equally important to have good producers, you know, because a story is fantastic on paper. It takes a lot of skill and craft to bring it alive. So oftentimes I find that, you know, people are reluctant to work with you know, more experienced producers, even though the project may demand it. And we give them that advice, but of course it's up to them to take it or reject it. But this is really how we work. We don't have any prescribed format. We never go out there and I don't remember Mahesh ever receiving a template from Amazon saying, Mahesh, you need to tell me these 17 things. And no, but we did ask for a lot of material and they were more than happy to share it. They said, this is how we're thinking about it. This is the story synopsis. And then, like I said, the first conversation, which was pre-pandemic and lockdown and all of that, was Fahad telling me, Vijay, I don't want to even increase it by a minute.
Yeah, that's fantastic. We've come to our end of our session with time running out. So Vijay and Mahesh, thank you so much for your time really appreciate it. So on behalf of Manorama Online, on behalf of all the participants who have come in, really wanted to appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You're most welcome. Thank you. It's been an honor to be here. Really appreciate it. Mahesh, always a pleasure to see you.
Thank you, Vijay. Thank you. Thank you.
And for the audience, stick on, because in 10 minutes time, we're going to start a panel discussion on online education. It's a fabulous set of panelists lined up. And during the break, please take the time out to go to the networking lounge and to the exhibitors hall. There are some very interesting things for you to do. See you in 10 minutes.